I just saved your life and you still don't trust me?
I don't trust anybody or anything.
Not even your own eyes? That's the gun that killed R. K. Maroon. And Doom pulled the trigger.
Doom? How the hell did you get in here?
Through the mail truck. I thought it would be best if I waited to die. See if I'm wanted for murder.
No kidding.
I'm glad. I was hoping you did. You did enjoy it.
It's so good. I'm thinking that we probably ought to just go back and watch the rest of the movie instead of listening to me yak.
Oh no! I was just watching it today. This morning again. It's great. But again, let's start off with the show. My name is Kronos. This is the Kronos Show, and I'm here with my co-host on DJC Game Studios, Chuck.
How you doing? Good to see you.
What I'm doing, and the amazing, awesome special guest today, Gary K. Wolf, creator of Roger Rabbit. How are you, sir?
Don't forget my buddy here.
And Roger.
Roger Rabbit, he's there right beside Gary K. Wolf. So other than that, this is great to have you for a second time. We had you about, 2 years ago or so? I think
it was either just before the pandemic or just at the start of the pandemic, yeah.
I think it was about the start of it, and I'm glad to have the second opportunity to just kind of rewind and talk about, you know, your books and Roger Rabbit and so forth.
I haven't been out of my office here since the last time we talked. So you got to tell me what's going on in the outside world.
Yeah, we've been locked up for a little bit more. You know, things are starting to get a little better, and it'll safer out there for us. But let's start off with a little bit of a rewind and origin story, a little bit how everything had begun for you, kind of, again, from last time, and your inspiration as a writer, you know.
Yeah. Well, I've always been fascinated by writing, and my writing career actually started when I was in either second or third grade, because my second or third grade teacher gave everybody in class a picture to color. And that picture was a farm scene, typical farm scene. It was a farmhouse. It was a barn. It was a fence, a meadow. And out in the middle of the meadow was a single cow. And you got to take it home and color it. And the object was to stay inside the lines. That was the only requirement. And I was better at staying inside the lines than anybody. So I took it home and I colored it. I colored the farmhouse yellow because that's the color farmhouses were in the town I came from. Colored the barn red, grass green, fence brown, perfect inside the lines. I come to the cow, and my mother had always told me that when people were alone, that they got sad, they got lonely, and they got blue. So I said, well, you know, works for people, must work for cows. So I colored the cow blue. And next day I turned the paper in. And day after that, the teacher handed them all back, all except for mine. She said, Gary, she said, would you come up here to the front of the class? And I thought, oh, I stayed inside the lines better than anybody. So she said, turn and face the class. And I turned and faced the class. And she said, all right. She held that picture of mine up over my head. And she said, class, she said, look at this stupid, stupid picture. She said, everybody knows that cows are brown, cows are black, cows are white. Sometimes cows are brown, black, and white, all three. She said, never, ever are cows blue. She says, Gary, don't you ever do anything that stupid again.
Wow.
She called my mother. And my mother had to go to school. And the teacher said to her, I think there's something wrong with Gary. He colored a cow blue. So, you know, that night, my folks called me into the living room, and my mom and my dad. And my mom said, you know, Gary, why did you do that? I had to go to school. Why did you do that? And I said, well, Ma, you know, it wasn't me. It was you. You were the one who told me that people sand lonely. They're blue. So cows sand lonely. I colored it blue. And she said, well, you go outside and play for a while. Your dad and I are going to have to talk about this. Well, I gotta understand my parents. Mm-hmm. My parents were children of the Depression. My dad had to quit school in the third grade to go to work. My mom had to quit school in the eighth grade to go to work. And so these were not what you would call upscale, urban, well-educated urban liberals. I mean, these were hard scrabble working folk. Yeah. And I didn't think this was going to have a good ending, but they called me back in and my mom said to me, she says, you know, Gary, your dad and I talked about this and we decided that the next time you want to color a cow blue, you go ahead and color a cow blue.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. And she called my teacher and said, let him do what he wants. Let him do what he wants. And so about 2 weeks later, we got another assignment, write a one-page paper on what we did on our summer vacation. And, you know, so people were writing that they went to Waukegan. People were writing that they went to Starved Rock, that they went to Wisconsin.
Yeah.
My paper was about how I went into my backyard and I used tin foil and tin cans and I built a rocket ship and flew to the moon. And nice. Passed it back and put it on my desk and says, well, that must have been a very interesting trip. So that was really where it all started. And, you know, luckily I had great parents. They encouraged my creativity. And I got to tell you, I've colored a lot of cows blue since then.
As you should. I mean, that is creative, you know. Oh, that's so great. That's such a great story. That's a good origin story.
An origin story. Definitely. The wolf origin story.
Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned, you know, Waukegan, and I know that you were born as do you pronounce it? Is it Earlville?
Earlville. Yeah, I wasn't born there. I was born in Berwyn. Okay.
Illinois.
Hospital. Because my mother did not want me to be born in Earlville, because first of all, there was no hospital. And secondly, she didn't want Earlville on my birth certificate. So the deal was her mother lived up in Cicero. And the deal was that when she was within a week of, her due date, she was going to go up and stay with her mother. And then when she went into labor with the hospital, my dad would drive up. He owned the pool hall in Earlville, and he would drive up and be there for the delivery. Well, on the day that she went into labor, it was the worst snowstorm that Illinois had ever seen. I mean, nothing was moving. And her father and her brothers, who were supposed to stay at the hospital, were snowed in at work and couldn't get out. So it was her and her mother home alone in this house, and she was in labor. And you gotta know the situation. They were in Cicero. They lived at 1913 South 50th, just behind them across the alley with 1914 South 49th was Al Capone and Al Capone's mother. And my grandmother and Al Capone's mother were besties. I mean, they were best friends.
Oh, wow.
And so when you've got when you got a problem in Cicero, what do? Well, you call Al Capone. So my grandmother called Mrs. Capone and said, oh my God, Hattie's in labor and she can't get to the hospital. She said, oh, don't worry, Ralphie will take her. Now, Ralphie was Al Capone's younger brother. Wow. And my mom could hear on the phone, Mrs. Capone say, Ralphie, Hattie Wolf's in labor. You go take her to the hospital. She says, I'm not going out in a storm. It's just snowing out there. She says, you take her to the hospital. By golly, 10 minutes later, this big black car pulls up out front. Ralphie Capone, my grandmother and my mother get in the car, and Ralphie Capone takes my mother to the hospital. And all the way there, he's saying, don't you have that kid in the back seat of my car? You have that kid in the back seat of my car. You deliver it and clean it up.
Yeah, the seats.
So that's my tie to the mob.
So I thought how could you top an origin story? That is not that. That's the best right there.
No, I can top that one too.
All right.
One of these stories I've never told publicly, but I'll tell you this one. You go fast forward 18 years, not actually 20 years, and I was in college, and I had to work my way through college. I could not, if I didn't have a summer job, I couldn't go back to college. Because my folks didn't have the money. So I had to work every summer. And the summer of my senior year, there was just nothing. I mean, there was nothing. So I was looking everywhere. And I said, Ma, I can't get a job. I'm not going to be able to go back to college. So, you know, you got a problem in Illinois. You call Al Capone. So Mrs. Capone was long gone. But my mom had been best friends with Al's sister, Betty. So she called Betty Capone in Cicero and said, hey, you got anything up there that Gary can do for the summer? And Betty Capone says, oh, yeah, have him drive up and talk to Ralphie, who, you know, had taken me to
that. Oh, yeah.
He was now the capo emeritus of the mob. And so I went to the Roosevelt Hotel to the top floor where they had a bunch of office suites. And Ralphie was up there in his office. And he reinvented history. So I remember that night your mother called and my grandmother said, oh no, it's too snowy. Ralphie can't go out. And I said, don't, no, Ma, I'm going. And all the while we drove, I said, don't worry, I'll get you there. And if you have that baby in the back seat of the car, I'll deliver it myself. So I asked him for a job and he says, you go talk to Tony. And that was Tony Arcaro, who was called Tough Tony, and Tough Tony was the capo of the mafia in Chicago at the time. Yeah. And so I went to talk to Tony, and Tony said, yeah, he said, every summer I hire on a bunch of college boys to run the numbers. You probably don't know what numbers running is, but the numbers was kind of the illegal early equivalent of the lottery. You would go to a shoeshine boy or, which we don't have anymore, but you would go to a hotel bellhop or a captain of a hotel or the maitre d' at a restaurant or any number of places, and you would place a bet. You would give the guy a dime, a nickel, or a quarter, and three numbers. And then based on the three horses that came in at certain races that were, you know, that day, you would hit your number. And if you hit your number, you could make $300-$400. So somebody had to go around to all these places and pick up the bags of money. And that was me. So they gave me a car and I drove around every day in Chicago and picked up bags of money and put them in the trunk of my car. And I took them. Yeah. The one rule was don't steal the money.
Right. Well, yeah.
I took them to the Roosevelt Hotel and took them up to the top floor where they had the counting room. And they had a gun ports in the door so that when you went in, and it was the whole floor of the Roosevelt Hotel, and it was floor to ceiling money. And there was money everywhere. So what with tips and salary that summer, I made more than my dad made. And by that time he was working in an electrical motor factory and I made more than my dad made. And so Tony brought me in for my exit interview. And he said, you know, he says, Gary, he says, I've had my eye on you. He said, you remind me of me when I was your age. He said, every summer I offer permanent employment in my organization to one young man. And this summer I want that young man to be you. He says, if you say yes, you know, you'll come into the organization. We'll get you a nice suit. Maybe I like shark skin. We'll get you a car, maybe a nice Cadillac. We'll get you a gun and you'll come into the organization.
Wow.
And I went home and I said to my mom, Tony offered me a job. I made more money than dad made. I'm going to take it. She says, you're going back to college. You're staying out of that business. And the guy, Davey Peluso, the guy who did take that job, next time I saw him, he had a Corvette. He had a sharkskin suit. I'm assuming he had a gun.
Yeah.
But, 12 years later, he also was in prison for.
Well, yeah, I guess that comes with the territory, I guess.
So right? I don't know what that has to do with creativity or Roger Rabbit.
No,
great story. Great. This is story time. This is what we're enjoying right now. So But as, being from, I mean, at least, in the, do you remember Waukegan in any way? You've been around, that's where
I'm at. I had a girlfriend up there, and it did not end well. So I suspect that what I do remember of Waukegan, you probably don't want to hear. I grew up in Earlville, as you know, and in those days, if you took a trip like 12 miles, that was a long trip because they didn't have nice highways and they didn't have reliable cars. I mean, your car could break down on you every 20 miles. And so there are towns within, you know, like a 50-mile radius of less than that, 25-mile radius of Roeville that I've never been to. But I went to Waukegan because I had a girlfriend there and I used to drive up occasionally. I went to school at the University of Illinois down in Champaign. And, you know, the difference between Northern Illinois and Southern Illinois is night and day. I mean, I probably have had, there are towns within 5 miles of Champaign-Urbana that I've never been to. And I wouldn't even know the names of. I think the thing about growing up in Illinois, especially during the 40s and 50s in a small town, is that there was a certain morality and an attitude about how you treated other people and how other people were expected to treat you. And I think that that's reflected in Roger Rabbit. I think that Roger Rabbit has that morality. Roger is a good rabbit and will do anything for you. And I think in an odd sort of way, Eddie Valiant has that attitude as well, although he's more brass knuckles. I've always thought that Eddie Valiant and Roger Rabbit together, if you could join them up, they make one good person, because Roger was all laughs and fun and good times, and Roger was all hard knuckles and by the book, and together they make one good person.
Cool. a quick one. This is out of the blue, just because I've lived in Waukegan my whole life. Do you like pizza? By any chance, I'm just asking.
Do I like pizza?
Yeah.
I put on the COVID-19 and I haven't taken it off. Of course.
I know there's this place.
My favorite food.
One of the things places I go to eat, it's been around for, I think, for such a long time. I think even more than 70 years. It's called Quonset Pizza, and that's where I usually go to. It's like one of the pizza joints that's been around since, you know, again, that time. So I'm wondering, do you recall that name at all by any chance?
I don't. And, you're a lot younger than I am. Everybody in the world is a lot younger than I am. But when I was growing up, pizza was a new thing. I mean, I remember the first time I walked it was in Ottawa, Illinois, and I walked into a place that had all my friends were talking about. They said, they've got this thing, it's called a pizza. I said, what is it? Well, it's hard to describe, but it's like a big cookie, except it's not so. I walked in and the guy who owned it was named Dewey. I'll never forget it. And I walked in with my friend, John Myers, and we ordered a pizza. I don't remember what kind. And I mean, we loved it. I mean, this was so great. We had never seen a pizza. We didn't know what this was. And then Dewey closed that pizza shop and there was no other pizza shop. And so we came down, we phoned him at home and said, where are you now? And he said, I moved my pizza shop to Troy Grove. I said, oh, okay. So we started driving to Troy Grove just to get a pizza. There was no place else to get pizza. In those days, what you had were, oddly enough, chili parlors. You would go into a store, a restaurant, and they would have 10 different kinds of chili. And that was it. And then when they started phasing out, the thing that came in was Chinese food. And you would go in and you would get American chop suey. And then when that phased out, then pizza came in. But I mean, pizza was not a big deal until I was probably a junior or senior in college. And, you know, even going to the University of Illinois in those years, what we would go out for at night was, of course, beer, you know, always popular, but we'd go out for bratwurst, which was, you know, the big Wisconsin, Illinois snack food at night. But pizzas, no. But if I'm ever in Waukegan, I will drop by. And I'm expecting that pizza place is going to give you a couple of free pizzas. In fact, I think they should deliver them tonight while you're still on the air.
There you go.
Hey, you know, I will send you one. My favorite place here, it delivers to pretty much anywhere.
I would literally do that for you. I cannot imagine what FedEx would do to a pizza.
Be smashed.
Let's get to, let's see. I think Frank Flint, if you're watching, he said he had a question. If he's got a question, let us know. But in the meantime, let's start off with DJC Game Studios with some, let's say, get into some Roger Rabbit questions and things like that. So if you want to go ahead.
I got a few or whatever we can get to, but I was wondering about, and this is going to be a lot of the movie adaption, to like the characters and sounds of characters. And the first thing was, you know, what did you want Roger to really sound like? And did Charles Fleischer sound exactly like you envisioned him to be with that? You know, please and all that stuff, you know.
Well, you got to realize that, you know, I'm the book writer, and I wrote the book, and the book was the book. And I knew what the characters looked like because I saw them in my head. Mm-hmm. I never heard them in my head, because in the book, in the first book, in this second and third and fourth books, they're slightly different. But in the first book, they did not talk with speech. They talk with word balloons. So when a cartoon character spoke, because they were the stars of newspaper and comic books. So when a cartoon character spoke, he put up a word balloon. And instead of listening to him, you read him. And if he turned around, then his word balloon turned around, and you had to go to the other side of the
other side to read. Nice. That's awesome.
And, you know, these word balloons would break off and go rolling down the street. And, you know, if you happen to hit a particularly heavy word balloon in your car.
Paragraph.
There were companies, the one I used was called Word Begone, which would clean the word balloons off your windshield because it requires a special solvent. And when somebody plays the piano, the notes would go up like this, and people would collect those and cut them into 8x12 sheets, and that's where sheet music came from. When somebody was killed with a tuned gun, produced a bang balloon, and you would pick that bang balloon up off the sidewalk or off the ground, and it was kind of brutal. You had to be careful with it. But if you got another gun and fired it, it would produce a bang balloon. And if the two bang balloons matched, same gun. So, you know, I had a lot of fun playing with that in the book.
That sounds amazing. I wish that would have been put into the movie.
Well, wait. When they first started making the movie, they wanted to stay true to the book. So they started the process with word balloons. Mm-hmm. And it became apparent very early on that, you know, the book was a book and the movie was a movie, two different mediums.
Yeah.
And it became apparent that if they had the characters speaking in word balloons, it basically became a silent movie. You know, the
character would say sense, something, yes, yeah.
And you know, you'd have to, the audience would have to read what he said, and it just didn't work. And so they came to me and said, you know, we've got to give them voices. And I said, yeah, sure, absolutely. I didn't think the book was filmable for that reason. And, you know, just lots of reasons, because I wrote it as a book that people had to use their imagination to enjoy and to read. And I didn't think a lot of my ideas were filmable, and a lot of them weren't, like the word balloons. So they called in Charlie Fleischer, whom I had seen in a comedy club in L.A. And Bob Zemeckis was there at the same time, just coincidentally. And we saw Charlie Fleischer doing this routine where he was impersonating Donald Duck having an orgasm. What? This is the guy. This is the guy who could do it. If anybody can do it. So we brought him in, and he sat down with Dick Williams, and they started going through different kinds of voices. Mm-hmm. And Dick Williams, who was the lead animator, was of opinion that every successful major cartoon character had some kind of a speech impediment. Porky Pig with his stutter, Daffy Duck, with the lisp, and they all had some kind of a speech impediment. So they tried all kinds of stuff. And Charlie actually came up with the stutter, but only on the letter P. He said, how about if he stutters on P? And he said, blah, 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 please. And it was, it was just perfect because he doesn't stutter all the time, but he will stutter occasionally. And it was just perfect. And now whenever I hear Roger or whenever I write Roger, I hear him with Charlie's voice.
That's awesome.
when we came to Jessica, totally different thing. Jessica is kind of the ideal woman. There have been surveys done that designate Jessica as one of the sexiest movie actresses of the 80s and occasionally of all time. And I'm thinking, well, she's a cartoon, for God's
sake. I believe it.
I kind of agree, but yeah.
I'm not going to make her ugly. So right. Bob Zemeckis, Bob Z had worked with Kathleen Turner on Romancing the Stone. And he came to me and said, what do you think about Kathleen? Hey, what do you think of Kathleen for the voice of Jessica Rabbit? I said, sign me up. I think she is one of the sexiest women that I have ever seen in my life. We brought Kathleen in, and she did the voice. But for some unknown reason, and whether she was pregnant at the time, and it could have been a breath control issue for her, but she could not sing the song. She couldn't sing the song. And so Steve Spielberg was there with Amy Irving, who was his wife at the time. Mm-hmm. And when it was obvious that Kathleen couldn't sing the song, Steve said to Amy, he says, hey, you sang in Yentl, why don't you give it a whack? And I said, Steve, people are not going to believe that Jessica has one voice when she sings and a totally different voice when she speaks. He says, oh, nobody will even notice. I'm like, okay, you're the boss. And so Amy Irving sang the song. They did all of this before there was any animation and before the movie actually came together. So Kathleen really had no idea whether this movie was going to be any good, whether this movie was going to be a super sensation or was going to be another Howard the Duck. She had, those of you who are laughing, you know what happened to Howard the Duck, the guy in a duck suit. So she said, yes, I'll do it, but I do not want screen credit. I will not take screen credit. That way, if it's a bomb,
ouch,
nobody will ever know. And if it's a success, I'll come up and say, I was the voice of Jessica Rabbit, which is what James Earl Jones did with the voice of Darth Vader in Star Wars. The same thing, because nobody knew if Star Wars was going to be any good. Well, of course, the movie is a smash hit, and now the fans are saying, well, why didn't Kathleen Turner get credit for that? Well, her choice, her choice. The interesting thing is that Amy Irving didn't have that kind of a problem, and she took credit. And if you sit and watch the credits, which go on for, I don't know, an hour and a half,
a lot.
About 32 minutes into the credits, you'll see Amy Irving singing voice of Jessica Rabbit. Yeah. I think the voice, and now whenever I hear Jessica, of course, I hear Kathleen.
That's so awesome. What amazing. A great story.
Let's see. Let's answer two quick questions from the audience, and then we're going to go into a little love with Jessica Rabbit. I got a quick film to show, but let's go into the first question. This is from Frank Flint, did you get inspiration about Roger Rabbit by watching Bugs Bunny for a cartoon rabbit idea?
Well, yes and no. When I was writing the book, and remember, you know, I was writing the book, I wanted the lead character to, and this was way before I had any affiliation whatsoever with Disney. It was just a guy sitting in my kitchen at 5 a.m. writing a book. Mm-hmm. I wanted the lead character to be a character that was a Disney kind of character that Disney didn't have. All right. You know, Warner's had Bugs. Disney had Oswald a long time ago, but didn't at that time have a rabbit. And I thought, well, I think I should do this as a kind of a Disney rabbit. And by Disney rabbit, I mean that Disney is an honest and honorable rabbit who will not lie to you, will tell you the truth, will help you out if you need a helping hand, as opposed to Bugs Bunny, who will tell you one thing and then sneak up behind you and put a stick of dynamite down your pants. You know? So, in a way, yes, I did get inspiration from Bugs Bunny, but only because I wanted a rabbit who wasn't Bugs Bunny. I wanted a Disney-esque kind of rabbit.
Okay, let's go for the next one. From Veronica Hernandez, any plans on being a part of any new films?
If you mean by being a part of appearing in them like Stan Lee, I'm going to be in all of them from now on. I get to ask this question a lot. Hey, what's going on with the sequel movie? And for years now, I've had to tell people basically the same thing. Stay tuned. You know, the first movie made $1 billion at the box office. Now, even in Illinois, that's big money. And when you're talking about that kind of money, a sequel generally makes 3/4 of that amount. So just from a monetary point of view, there's a lot of incentive to do a sequel movie. There's an artistic incentive to do it because the first one was so good that people love the characters and they want to see more of them. So sooner or later, it is my belief that you will see a sequel movie. I can't tell you when and I can't tell you how, but sooner or later that will happen. And as for me, I got tons of other things. I'm currently working on a new live action animated movie with a totally different studio that will be very Roger Rabbit-y. And ooh. Yeah, totally new line of characters because it's a totally different studio. All A-level people, A-level writers, A-level director, awesome. A-level stars, A-level everything. But in the Hollywood industry, the studio announces a movie. I can't announce it. So when the studio announces it, I'll tell you guys, but it's...
Then we'll get you back on. We're going to talk about it.
Yeah, for sure.
And you'll know. You'll know. All right.
Yeah. I was wondering too, because it's like the book that first came out was Who Censors Roger Rabbit? And then they, of course, they changed the name to Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Yeah. And the other ones, and is the second movie would be a second movie if there was, you know, hopefully, who plugged Roger Rabbit.
Disney owns the rights to that. Yeah.
And then who whacked Roger Rabbit. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I'm always, you know, that was one of my other questions, which you pretty much answered. Like, man, I would hope to see those come up right after.
There's all kinds of ways you could go because a lot of people, were saying what you guys were saying, that they would have loved to have seen the movie using the word balloons. And there is a kind of a groundswell to do the sequel movie based on the first book and the story in the first book. And do word balloons. I don't know. The third novel, Who Whacked Roger Rabbit, is probably the one that is most filmable because it has a good story, good mystery, kind of families well with the first movie. And that one is most filmable. Don't forget my latest novel, which is Jessica's yes. Serious Business, in which I tell the Jessica Rabbit origin story, because people are always asking me, well, where did Toontown come from? Where did Toontown come from? And nobody ever asked me, but I think I should answer the question anyway. Where did Jessica Rabbit come from? So in the book, I answer all those questions. And Jessica is human. She is a poor, not too attractive shop girl working in a cut-rate toy store. And through a series of misadventures and adventures, she hooks on with an organization called Sirius. And Sirius is a spy organization, and she becomes a female James Bond. And in the course of pursuing a master criminal, she has a lot of adventures. But the book, and I can't tell you too much because
Let me jump in real quick.
My editor told me that when he was reading it, he said that there are what he would call, and I can't say this. I can't say this on the air. Say, oh, wow moments. But it was not wow. It was, oh, wow moments where all of a sudden you realize what's going on. And you think, oh, my God, I didn't see that coming. There are many, many of those in the book where all of a sudden you realize what's going on. And show the cover of the book again, because that's a good story, too.
Just graphic series business, yes, and you can also go on the website, which is also in the description. You can also buy the book right here, so absolutely. You can.
And I think everyone should. I buy and
hold. Oh, yeah. I want to.
They make great presents. But when I was doing the cover, I did not want to show Jessica Rabbit, the movie Jessica Rabbit, because in this book, Jessica Rabbit is human. And so I wanted a different kind of representation of Jessica Rabbit. I wanted something that said, hey, this is Jessica Rabbit, but not the Jessica Rabbit from the movie. And I had an artist who did a lot of my book jackets, and I told him what I wanted, and he just couldn't seem to get it. I don't know what was wrong with him, but he just couldn't seem to get it. And then one day, out of the blue, this guy, Andy Prisney, is an Italian guy, sent me that picture. And he said, would you post this on your Facebook page? Is it good enough to post on your Facebook page? And I took a look at it and I said, Andy, I said, I'm going to do more than that. I'm going to put this on the cover of the book. I mean, this
boom.
Is
yeah.
And I said, how much would you charge me? And he says, oh, no, you can have it free. I said, no, that's not the way art works. You know, I'm going to pay the other guy, which I did. And the cover was perfect. So, you know, for all you fans out there, this was a guy who had never done a book jacket in his life. I mean, he's incredibly, incredibly talented guy. Follow him on Facebook. Every day he does 20 drawings that are just mind-blowing. But, I mean, he's never had anything on a cover of a book. And he said,
it's kind of beautiful.
Sent it to me over the transom, and there it is. And if you look, you'll see Roger behind the little thing that says danger. You'll see the – and he didn't even know what the book was about. And he captured it perfectly. So,
nice. So right here in GaryOwenWolf.com, you can find anything from, you know, about me, you know, about himself, his works, podcast, blog, his contacts, and then you can even get the audiobooks here.
Audiobooks, yeah.
Very cool.
Thank God they all came out in audiobooks, because the way I used to do that, people would send me money, and then they would call me up on the phone, and I would read them the book. And, I mean, it just took forever. So I'm glad that we finally came out with the audio book.
Amazing. That's great. Let's go into some Jessica Rabbit. I got a short clip here I put together of some of the when you go on his Facebook link is also in the description, but you also see a lot of the artwork that people showcase for him, and he puts all their, you know, a lot of the cosplay too. A lot of women do. So I picked some of my favorites and a little bit of mixed up a quick video and for you guys to watch and check this out. I want everyone to hold yourself together because this is
this is very sexy.
Let me get this stop screen out of the way and then we can go here.
You had plenty of money in 1922. Some other man do. Get out of here.
She's married to Roger Rabbit.
Yeah. What a lucky girl.
Now if you had prepared 20 go, you wouldn't be wandering now from door to door. Why don't you do right like some other men do? Get out.
There we go.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Again. Yeah, it's just
I love the cosplay ones. Those are my favorite.
I gotta tell you a story. I told you a lot of stories, but I'll tell you this one. Growing up in Earlville, through some genetic fluke, the boys outnumber the girls by 35-1. So, I mean, good luck getting a date if you're the president of the Checkers Club, right? I mean, there was just no chance. And so I did not have what we would call a lot of romantic experiences until much later in life. And if I knew then that at this point in my life, probably, I think I've never done a rough count, but I'm guessing probably 20 or 30 curvaceous, attractive young women every week would be sending me pictures of themselves dressed as Jessica Rabbit, I would have written the book a whole lot sooner.
Right. Oh my God. That is so cool. Just to see that fans, that's what's really fun going. And I'm sure you do go to like the Comic Cons and stuff like that.
I used to, I'm getting kind of older now, and they're a little too taxing for me, you know, standing up on cement floors for 3 days. But when I used to, and I would always judge a Jessica Rabbit lookalike contest. Jessica Rabbits would always come up to me. And one thing about the Jessica cosplayers, the thing about Jessica that makes her so appealing to cosplayers is because any woman can play her. You know, if you're a little thin, well, you can pad yourself out, or You can play her thin, works. If you're a little heavier, works really well, you know. And to me, it takes a lot of courage for a young woman or a middle-aged woman to cosplay Jessica Rabbit, because there's a lot of skin there. And it takes a lot of courage. And when some young woman sends me a picture of herself cosplaying Jessica Rabbit, I always put it on my Facebook page. And as far as I'm concerned, they're all equal. I have gotten comments from my Facebook friends, Facebook followers, saying, "Hey, what'd you put that woman on there for? She's ugly, or she's too fat, or she's too thin." And when I first started doing that, and when people put those kinds of comments, I would write them a note and say, "Hey, don't do that anymore. That's strike one." And I'd give them two strikes, but no more. One strike and you're out.
Right.
You know, I am the grand and almighty potentate of Toontown. And if you don't like my rules, go someplace else with different rules. You know, nobody can criticize a cosplayer on my page. Nobody. It doesn't hold just for women. I get men who cosplay Jessica Rabbit. People of color. I have black cosplayers, Asian cosplayers. One of the best Jessica Rabbit cosplayers is Asian. And cool. I have men who cosplay Jessica Rabbit. I have bodybuilders who cosplay Jessica Rabbit. And then there's the whole subset of the gender benders. I have people who cosplay Jessica Rabbit as a guy. They call him Jesse Rabbit. And some of those are just adorable. And they're all welcome. The rainbow colored tent of Toontown is big enough to
include everyone. Yeah.
Very awesome. Nicely said. I love everything that's on there, from people to have their drawings and just grab a cosplay. It's all great.
The same thing. I do not differentiate between a drawing that has been done by somebody who worked on the movie and animated the characters, and some third grader who is doing it first time out of the box. All are equal, and I will post them all. I generally get a lot of fan letters, and I post. I don't post them all because I get so many, but the ones that are special to me, I post. And it's just a lot of fun for me. I got one. Couple of weeks ago, they said, "Gee, you showed so much promise in your early days. Too bad you're a failure."
What?
Has this guy got me confused with the other nerdy wolf? I don't know.
Said, yeah, that's weird.
So much promise in your early days. Too bad you're a failure. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know how you failed when you had like the biggest animated movie of all time and all the success with the books. Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. we have a few more chat questions here.
Yeah, let's have them.
Oh, I think Kronos is glitching out there.
So, well, let me tell you the Bugs Bunny story.
That's what we were talking about before we came on air. Yes.
So when we were doing the movie, Steve Spielberg wanted to get the Warner Brothers characters. Now, this was 1985. We started making the movie in 1980. And in 1981, Roy Disney went to Warner Brothers and said, "Hey, we're making this live action animated movie, and we'd like to have Bugs Bunny come on and do a little cameo." And he would just come on and he would say, "Hey, what's up, Doc?" And walk off. How about that? And Warner Brothers said to Roy Disney, "Get lost. Get lost. There's no way."
Because that's like direct competition for them, right?
And there is no way that Bugs Bunny is ever going to be in a Walt Disney movie. Well, 5 years later, when Steve Spielberg walked in and made the exact same request, "Can we have Bugs Bunny for a cameo?"
Right.
Okay.
Welcome back.
Of course you can.
Steven Spielberg, of course, right?
You know, what about Porky Pig and Wile E. Coyote and the Roadrunner? and how about Yosemite Sam and Tweety Bird and Putty Tad? Take them all. So he took them all, and the rights for all of those characters were next to nothing. I mean, it was minimal. However, Bugs Bunny, being a cartoon superstar, had a contract, and in his contract, it specified that Bugs Bunny had to be in every scene with Mickey Mouse because they were co-equal superstars. So you could not have Mickey Mouse in a scene without Bugs. All right. Now there is one scene where Bugs is in the scene alone without Mickey. Mickey didn't have a contract, but every time Mickey's on screen, Bugs is there with him. The interesting thing about that is that the Warner Brothers people wanted Disney to use the 1988 version of the characters, which are different from the 1947 version, certainly different, because they wanted to sell their current modern merchandise. So the Disney animators wanted to use the 1947 versions. So what they basically did was two versions of the movie. They did one animated version using the 1947 characters and one using the 1988 characters. They showed the 1980s characters to Warner Brothers and put the 1947 characters in the movie. And Warner Brothers did not realize that the 1947 characters were in the movie until the movie came out.
And oh, no kidding. That's crazy.
Warner's was that they went ballistic. And luckily, the movie was a smash success and won four Academy Awards. And Warner's backed off and realized that that they could now sell not only the 1980s characters as plus both but also the 1947 characters. So, but the guy who did that animation, the guy who was responsible, he got fired.
Right.
one little vignette from the Bugs Mickey scene when Bugs and Mickey are parachuting down. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's the 1947 Bugs. It looks like 1947 Bugs. Well, the Disney animators were so pissed off at the Warner Brothers people that there's something called gags in the margins, and film goes through a camera at 24 frames a second. So you in order to match that up with the live action, you have to do 24 drawings or 24 cells per second. Now, the animators found out in real early animation that you could screw around with six 24ths of a second. You could put little gags in and nobody could see it. Oh. Through too fast. So there is a gag in the margin. And if you watch it freeze frame, which you can now do on a DVD, if you watch it freeze frame, what the Disney animators wanted to do was as Bugs and Mickey were coming down, they wanted Mickey to give Bugs the finger. Six frames, nobody's ever going to see it. So they were doing all the animation work at Dick Williams Studio in England, and Dick had hired animators from all over the world. Really, it was like a little United Nations. He had brought in animators who had left the Iron Curtain countries, Russia, Spain, Portugal. There were animators for everywhere, top of their field. But it was like a Tower of Babel. Nobody spoke the same language. So if you wanted to talk to the guy from Portugal, you had to go to the guy from Italy, and he would talk to the guy from Spain, and he would talk to the guy from Portugal, and then come back around. And so I think the guy who actually did, I don't know where he was from, but he was from one of the Iron Curtain countries, and they conveyed to him that they wanted Mickey to give Bugs the finger. And he got it wrong. So if you watch it freeze frame, you'll see that clearly it is Bugs giving Mickey the finger.
You got to check it out.
Oh yeah, that is definitely something to check
totally
out.
Wrong message. Now,
pause.
Something else that I just discovered last week, actually, that I didn't know. And I told you the gags in the margins are six cells. So six 24ths of a second. Well, in that parachute scene, there is a gag in the margin that is one cell, 1/24th of a second. And when Bugs is parachuting out, as his parachute opens, if you freeze frame that, just as his parachute is opening, you will see written on his unfurling parachute, Ringo is the walrus. And
what? Yeah. No kidding. They got some Beatles.
And this was in the days of the Beatle.
Yeah.
Easter eggs.
And I am the walrus. And the guys in the animation department were probably listening to I am the walrus. And we're checking around. He said, well, probably Ringo is the walrus. And so Ringo is the walrus. And
that is so cool.
real quick. Secrets. We got a few questions in the the chat. But first, I wanted to get one more question. Another question from DJ Game Studios, and then we'll pop in with the other questions.
See. I think a lot of them we were actually talking about. This is kind of, and I think you may have answered this, but you had like some A-list people working in the movie. And you had like Christopher Lloyd, great as a villain. Oh my God, just his lines and everything. What role, if any, did you play in like approval of actors or anything in casting when because these are your characters. So,
sure. Part of the deal was that I just sold the rights to the book. So I still own the characters. And so I really needed my approval, but let's be honest here. I mean, I'm a writer, right? I mean, I wrote the book. And when I'm sitting on a movie set or when I'm sitting in an office and I'm sitting in there with Bob Zemeckis, probably one of the greatest directors of all time, and Steve Spielberg, probably the even better director of all time. And saying to me, hey, what do you think of Kathleen Turner? Am I going to say?
You're like, woohoo, yes.
We could do better. Yeah, we could do better. The one that gave them the most trouble was Eddie Valiant because they wanted somebody bankable just in case this movie was not a success. They wanted somebody that people would come to see just because of they were a famous actor. So the first actor they got was Bill Murray, and they signed a book.
What?
I didn't know enough about it. They did some filming with Bill Murray, and he was totally wrong because he was the one that had to convince people that the rabbit was real. And if he didn't do that, then the whole movie fell apart. And it turned out that Bill Murray didn't believe the rabbit was real. He was always saying, "Whoa, you're a talking rabbit," you know. And so they had to pay him off $1 million, buy him out of his contract. Ooh. And we started looking at other people. We looked at James Woods, we looked at Kurt Russell, looked at a lot of people, and then they found the guy that said, this is the perfect Eddie Valiant. And then, of course, was Eddie Murphy. Well, we're going to black Eddie Valiant now, which is fine. It became obvious after a month of filming with him that he wanted to be funnier than the tunes. So we were constantly rewriting the script to make Eddie Valiant funnier than the tunes, and that didn't work. So he got bought out of his contract, and he got $1 million plus a new Ferrari. So we're starting to see how you make money in Hollywood.
Why not just even dipping your toes into something you don't work for or work on?
Yeah, in the meantime, on the other side of Hollywood, the other side of town, they're making The Untouchables, and the director really wanted Robert De Niro for the role of Al Capone, but De Niro said, "No, I'm sorry, I'm committed. I can't be in The Untouchables." So the director got his second choice, which was a relatively little known guy named Bob Hoskins, and Bob Hoskins came in and he was going to be Al Capone. Well, then all of a sudden, Bobby De Niro comes in and says, hey, I rapped early and I could be Al Capone. So they fire Bob Hoskins, and now he's got $1 million and nothing to do. So so they said, hey, let's bring in this Hoskins guy. Jesus, he's British. I thought he was an incredible actor. I'd seen everything he'd done, Mona Lisa.
Well, I didn't even know he was British.
Oh, yeah, the Mona Lisa, the Long Good Friday. He's not just British, he's Cockney British. He's got a really thick Cockney accent. And I said, there is no way that Bob Hoskins is ever going to portray Eddie Valiant, who was the prototypical L.A. private eye. There's just no way he can do that. Yeah. So they brought him in. I said, let's have a reading. So they brought him in, and they did a reading, and he was standing there on a bare stage doing a reading with nothing, and he made you see the rabbit. I mean, he was amazing, amazing. And his American accent was perfect. Yeah. You know, people always ask me, do you have any regrets about the movie? Anything that you're sorry happened? And I have one really major regret. I mean, Bob Hoskins did the most incredible job of acting that I have ever seen in my life. And he didn't even get nominated for an Academy Award. Yeah. I believe it's because he made it look too easy. You know, nobody realized that he was making all of that stuff up in his head. There was nothing there, nothing around. Yeah. He was all by himself on a soundstage. And it was an example. When he was handcuffed to the rabbit, if you look at those handcuffs are a spring. And so he had to remember which way to turn his hand, and by turning his hand, which way that would turn the rabbit's hand, because it was on a spring. So he was, it was like acting in five dimensions. And I just regret that he didn't at least get nominated for an Academy Award for that role, because he deserved it.
Yeah, that's
100%.
They got a few. What was it, the sound effects editing? They won that one. The sound film editing, the visual effects one. And yeah, but you're right about that.
Special one for Dick Williams.
I love the animation style of of Roger Rabbit and just you can just tell a classically animated kind of character, as opposed to something like a Family Guy or something that's new. Like, I love the emotion and the movement and the face, and just it's just that classic animation style that it really shines through in this movie.
It goes beyond that too. When Eddie Valiant comes into the back room, and Roger is back there in the back room of the bar, and Roger is back there with Dolores, and Roger bumps the light, and the light starts swinging back and forth, and the shadows change, and so the shadows change on the people and on Roger, and that was so calm. It looks simple. I mean, hey, bump the light, but it is such a complicated thing to do that now is called bumping the light.
Oh, no kidding. It was named after it then.
In animation, it's called bumping the light just because of that. Yeah.
Yes. And then the part where I was going to kind of ask this as well, was and I know it's a lot to do with movie, but of your characters, but like a lot, like that scene with Jessica Rabbit, when she's literally touching him and pulling the scarves, and it's like, what is he working with? Was there like a stand-in that they animated over, or it's just real how they're interacting with a real person, you know?
Yeah, we filmed it in London at Elstree Studios, and it was a three-story soundstage. On the top floor were the sets. On the second floor were puppeteers who were manipulating objects through holes in the floor. All right. And then on the ground level were video monitors. And that's actually where Bob Z was. He was down there looking at it on video monitors. And as he was watching the monitors, he had animators who were drawing on the monitors so he could see the relationship between the characters and the live actors.
Wow, like in real time.
Yeah. No kidding. That necktie thing, They had something that came up from the floor that grabbed his necktie and pulled it down. When, you know, when Roger was submerged in the sink and came up and spitting water, they had a like a little fountain that came up and boom, spit it. And then they would animate over it. That's another reason why Hoskins really.
Yeah.
Because when he grabbed the rabbit, he had to remember to grab the rabbit like this. And when he grabbed him by the ears, he had to remember to grab him like this, because if he grabbed him like this, they had to animate between his fingers, and that would add an extra $100,000 a minute. So,
jeez.
You know,
they got the money now.
Like, oops, retake. You know.
All right, let's see. we have four questions here with the audience. Let's get those in, and then we'll go into closing after some of these questions. And I got one from Frank on Flint. Here's another question. With the idea to create the acid dip in Roger Rabbit that the cartoon feared?
They needed a threat, and this wasn't in the book. This was something that came up in the movie. But we needed a threat, and, you know, Toons can get hit on the head with a piano. Roger got hit on the head with a refrigerator and walked away from it. So you needed a threat, something that could kill a toon. And we kicked around a lot of stuff, and it's the dip is basically to toons what kryptonite is to Superman. It's something that only affects toons. Like, you know, you and I can juggle kryptonite, no problem, but Superman. We just came up with something that would only kill a toon, and it actually looks a lot like kryptonite. It's green and it's kind of glowing and whatever.
Okay. Next one is a kind of a fun one too. Here, this one is: will Roger Rabbit have a family in the near future, like baby rabbits?
Well, you know, I play kind of fast and loose with the rules of Toontown, and if you read my second novel, and everyone should who plugged Roger Rabbit, Jessica has a baby, and you have to get to the end of the novel to find out what that baby looks like, and. Possibly even who was the father. I don't know. But I did what they used to do on a lot of TV series, and they still do in cartoons and newspaper strips. Somebody will have a baby, and then the next season, that baby is forgotten. It's like,
yep.
You know, on Bewitched, where they had Darren, and they had six different guys who played Darren during the course. You know, I kind of played fast and loose, so the baby does not make another appearance. Jessica's twin sister is in the second movie.
What? Let's go.
They're identical twins, except Jessica's twin sister, who's called Joellen. They're identical, except that Joellen is only 6 inches high. She and Eddie have a relationship, which is was a lot of fun to describe.
I got one right here.
Girlfriend in your pocket right there. Yeah.
The uniqueness of your originality is just out of this world, like your blue cow.
It makes me feel good. And you know, I got to tell you, I have spent my entire life trying to make my parents proud of me and trying to validate the fact that they believed in that blue cow. And I think I've done it. I'm never really sure, but I hope so.
Okay, thanks. And then from Michael here, and get his here. What do you think of the cameo in Rescue Rangers? Did you see that new Rescue Rangers movie?
Yeah, too short. Sure. Like 15 minutes longer, and I would.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. Let's see. I have one here. Before we get to the finish, what time of day? Whether it's day or night, do you get your it's like your writing abilities, the best time that you just start writing? Is it like certain times at night or day where you just like, boom, here's the idea?
I write best in the mornings. I get up 5 in the morning, and I generally write from, I don't know, 5 until whenever I burn out, which is usually between 9 and 10. And then I do other stuff during the day. I do yoga every day. I ride a bicycle every day. I was a serious marathon runner. I used to run 12 to 15 miles a day and then 30 on Sundays. And I also meditate twice a day. And I have found that the biggest aid to my creativity is like vigorous exercise, like running. I got a lot of ideas while I was running. And I used to worry that I would get an idea and I would forget it before I got home. And sometimes I did, but it always, always came back. I get a lot of ideas when I do yoga, and I get tons and tons of ideas when I meditate. It's just, you put your mind into neutral, and the ideas just flood in. I don't think I'm unique. I think everybody, I've always believed that everybody can write a book. I don't think there's any unique talent to it. And I do not write books. I'm called on Wikipedia, I'm called the premier American humorist. Like the Mark Twain of the era. And I think that's kind of humorous to me, because in my mind, I don't write funny books. My books are all deadly serious. And I'm surprised when somebody said, wow, I read your book and it was just laugh out loud funny. And I say, yeah. Well, it's a serious book. What do you mean? I also don't write to please anybody else. I write for myself. I write to keep me entertained. And I'm just tremendously fortunate that what keeps me entertained also entertains the millions and millions and millions of other people.
Yeah. That is awesome.
Amazing. Let's get ready for closing. Chuck, did you have any, if I'm done, I'm good with questions. Did you have any final question you must get out, or any after that?
I think we really talked about most of the stuff. I was, the other thing, I think you had mentioned a little bit of inspiration stuff, but like, I got to ask, like, growing up, what was your favorite cartoons to watch?
You know, Donald Duck. No question. And still Donald Duck. I used to go to a little theater in Earlville, and they would change the program four times a week. And there was always a cartoon in front. And of course, this was before, we were poor. We didn't have a television until later. So you couldn't see cartoons anywhere else. And I was always just praying for a Donald Duck cartoon. Because I just thought he was so funny that, he got into such scrapes and you couldn't understand a word he said. Two stories are closing, and one of them kind of ties into that, what I just said, but two stories. When they premiered the movie, at Radio City Music Hall, in New York City, so that I wouldn't have to come to LA, that I could just I live in Boston, so I could just go down to New York. So I went to Radio City, and I had never seen the entire movie all the way through because they were still working on it up to a week before they released it. I mean, I think if they had their druthers, they'd still be working on it today. But I had never seen it all the way through, and I had never seen my credit on screen. So I was sitting in the upper balcony, which is where all the VIPs were sitting. And I was going to watch my movie all the way through for the first time. I was going to see my credit on screen for the first time. And on my left was sitting Kathleen Turner. And on my right was sitting Amy Irving. So I'm sitting there between two of the most beautiful women
I've
seen in my life. And I'm getting ready to watch my movie and my credit. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, life just doesn't get any better than this.
Right.
By God, life got better. Because Kathleen reached over and grabbed my leg. And she whispered in my ear, she said, Gary, are you excited? And I said, Kathleen,
yep.
No idea.
Even more.
One final story. I told you about gags in the margins, just little six-second things. Well, Stephen wanted to make sure that all of the key players in the movie had his or her favorite cartoon character in the movie as a cameo. So Bob Hoskins was Heckle and Jekyll. Dick Williams was Droopy. Bob Z's was the Roadrunner Wile E. Coyote. And so Stephen came to me and he said, what's your favorite character? I want to make sure I get it in the movie. And I said, Steve, you know, I got Roger, I got Jessica, I got Baby Herman. I think I'm covered. You know, I don't think you have to do anything. He says, we'll do something for you too. So actually that scene that you showed, if you watch that on freeze frame and slow it down, freeze frame, you will see that in 6 frames, as Eddie Valiant comes into Toontown, when the curtains open, 6 frames, if you look over to the left, you're going to see a yellow farmhouse, a red barn, a green meadow, a brown fence, and a blue cow standing all by itself in the middle of the field.
And comes full circle. That is beautiful.
You got to look out for that. I hope it's in the it's in there. I'm going to, as we finish, I'm going to play that intro that I as the outro on the way out of the any more stories, we could stay. I'll hear another hour if you're good. I know we this has been an incredible
a lot of fun, guys. Thank you. I had a good time.
Great time.
I wanted to first before I make my final statement. DJ Game Studios, do you have a final statement?
No, this has been amazing. It's great meeting you, Gary. Like this is I can't wait for what's next, you know. Whenever we find that out, I'm going to be excited for that.
There's the movie. I'm also doing a 12 episode live action animated TV series that's going to be set in a Toontown-esque jazz club, starring a cartoon wolf named Harry Wolf. So when those come about, we'll talk again. Okay.
Very cool.
For sure. Yeah, definitely be awesome. I wanted to thank you for the opportunity again for joining us. And everyone who is wants to see, there's a lot of information or the link to his Facebook, to also to his website is at GaryWolf.com. You can find all that there, the links and all that. But especially check him out on his Facebook. The link's there as well. Again, I'm saying it's just you can see everything, all the love for Roger Rabbit and everything else he's doing. I want to thank everyone who was joining in on today's show, from Switchbit to Frank Flint, Veronica Hernandez, Denise Hernandez, and we got Michael Killy, and then we see who else jumped in with us, and those who, you know, everyone else who will be seeing this later on. Again, thank you for the inspiration you've given us through the years, and that we will keep on receiving from you, you know, through the years. You definitely inspire us. I'm actually in the middle of something I've been doing for years and trying to figure out how I want to do my own book. And what I've been trying to do is just kind of like, it's all there. So I'm just trying to, you know, as we gain inspiration from people like yourself, I want to thank you so much for this.
And meditate. There you go. It'll come. Miles, one or the other.
A lot to think about when doing that.
Yes. So let me get the quick banner out of the way and let's say our goodbyes here. And I'm gonna play the that intro that maybe we can find that that blue cow in there. And if anyone again, Gary or DJ Game Studios, I'm gonna play the outro if you guys wanna jump out or stay and say goodbye afterwards, or again we'll just say goodbye here. Thank you for all those for watching the show.
Thank you
with Gary K. Wolf and DJ Game Studios. Take care and see you till next time. Okay.
Take care.
I just saved your life and you still don't trust me?
I don't trust anybody or anything.
Not even your own eyes? That's the gun that killed our Cameroon. And Doom pulled the trigger.
Doom?